Okay, if we are thinking about the Battle of the Atlantic, the original Battle of the Atlantic, let's put it this way. What is it we are seeing? We are seeing stereotypical, we are seeing convoys and escorts and U-boats on the other side. So we are seeing, basically, you might say, a naval theater there with two navies on both sides of the conflict. And so we are seeing a traditional marine naval conflict. And what I'm talking today is nicknamed as basically as a war, court war. But of course, actually, if we are thinking about it, it was not a war. It was an international conflict that never reached the full scale of a war. I think that's really important to understand at the beginning. And if we are thinking about actors involved, on the British side, it was the Royal Navy involved. But why was it that the Royal Navy became involved? It was because the Fishery Protection Squadron was still part of the Navy. Fishery Protection Service in the UK are part of the Royal Navy. And therefore, it was basically that the UK sent over the Fishery Protection Service. Germany, one of the other nations involved in the conflict, did the same thing. They also sent over the Fishery Protection Service boats, but these boats at that time, as a consequence of World War II, were no longer part of the German Navy, but operated by the Ministry of Agriculture and therefore considered civilian vessels. That will become important later on. And on the Icelandic side, what is it? There is no Icelandic Navy, as you know. There is no Icelandic military. There's a Coast Guard, and the Coast Guard is operating a number of armed, comparable small Coast Guard cutters, and they were the main tool on the Icelandic side. Okay, so in the beginning, the Battle of the Atlantic, the second one, was maybe not really a real war, and the term of the court wars during the heydays of the Cold War. It is a term coined by a British journalist, and of course, if you're thinking about this kind of playing with words, it was brilliant to make it well known in the UK, and so playing around with these words worked fine, and therefore it simply stuck. If we are thinking about the main subject of the war, that means North Atlantic Cod and Gadus Mohua, and to use the Latin name of the fish, it's a whitefish. And it's a whitefish that is really the main target species for the British fisheries, of the British distant water fisheries. British distant water fisheries are going for various species of whitefish, but in particular for Gadus Mohua, that means the Atlantic cod. And if you are thinking about the Atlantic, and probably not many of you will know, what is the Atlantic from the perspective of a fisherman? From the perspective of a fisherman, the Atlantic is mainly a desert. Why? Because the deep water basins of the Atlantic are completely irrelevant to fisheries. In the deep water basin, you have not enough of a concentration of a certain species to allow for commercial fishing operation. Therefore, instead of going to the deep sea basins, only very few small areas adjacent to the coast are relevant for fisheries in the Atlantic. Of course, if you're thinking here on the North American side, it is mainly the Grand Banks of Newfoundland, to name the most important in the American context. And if you are looking on the European side, it is a complete European shelf. That means those shallow areas, normally water depth below 200 meters or something like this. And then in the middle of the Atlantic, there's the Icelandic shelf and a little bit off east of Greenland. But you need to understand that the Atlantic itself in the center is basically completely irrelevant for any kind of commercial fisheries. And when it comes to the other element, you need to understand that, if you are thinking about the Atlantic, it is, whenever talking about an ocean, there's a question, who owns the ocean? And of course, if we are going far back in history, can go back to the Treaty of Tordesillas in 1494, where the Pope basically divided the world into two halves and into two spheres of interest, one sphere of interest for Portugal, the other one for Spain, and therefore the world simply divided in part, and divine authority used to solve a problem that was not fully existing at that time, but became a problem. Then, only a couple of years later, more than a century later, a Dutch lawyer was hired by the Dutch East India Company, and his name was Hugh de Groot, and he became famous under his Latinized name, Hugo Grotius, and he wrote this famous book, Mare Liberum, The Free Seas, and that is until today the backbone of our understanding as the oceans being coming access or being free seas and the freedom of the seas. But why was it that he wrote this book? And of course, it was a theoretical approach to it that he concluded if there's an endless resource, like fisheries at that time were understood, there is no harm if anybody is using it. That was his philosophical approach. But on the other hand, it was an idea that he wrote this whole treaty as a commissioned research project by the Dutch East India Company, arguing against the Treaty of Tordesillas, arguing against the Spanish and Portuguese claim to the whole of the ocean. So in itself, the concept of the freedom of the seas is going back to a Dutch colonial development process. And in the Western context, it has become the most accepted pattern that the ocean is a global common, but it's not the only way to think about it. If we are looking at early modern, late medieval patterns in the Asian world, for example, we are seeing societies where it's easily possible to own a piece of ocean, to have usage rights about a certain piece of ocean, but not in the Western understanding. That's a little bit of philosophical background, legal background to what was happening, but I think it's necessary to understand that there's this one approach that's basically using the freedom of the seas, and then there's on the other side the context that you can own the ocean, that you can have usage rights of the ocean. And there's of course a middle ground, and the middle ground is that a certain stretch of the ocean adjacent to the coast is under the control of the coastal nation. It means we are talking territorial waters, we are talking exclusive economic zones, and that everything else is open to all. So this is basically the background when it comes to the main mechanism. Okay, what is happening around 1900, and why is it important to understand what's happening after the war, after the Second World War? Around 1900, that means basically in the late 1880s in particular, people in the UK and people in Germany, also in some of the other European nations, but the UK and Germany are the leading nations, are combining certain innovations. They are combining the steam engine, and they are combining the railroad for distribution. They are combining some improvements in ship design and in net design, and we are seeing the first steam trawlers. So fishing is no longer sailing boats, but now we are seeing steam trawlers. And what is it they are catching? Of course, fish, but how is it they are preserving the fish? In a traditional boat in the European context that was going to sea, the fish was brought ashore alive. And there was a compartment in the ship where there was seawater in the compartment, and the fish was brought ashore alive. And now, with the steam trawlers, the fish is headed and gutted and then put on ice. And this is so-called fresh fish we are talking about, and that means the operational range of these ships can be dramatically increased, but at the same time, they are still limited. Why? Because if you're putting a fish on ice, then you have, on average, 18 to 20 days before it's no longer usable for human consumption. And that means 18 to 20 days is the maximum operational range for operation of a traditional steam trawler. And if you are thinking about the journey, if you are thinking about distribution in the country, that brings you to a range where you can go to Iceland, but where you can't go any further than Iceland, simply because of distance. So this type of technology was limited to the Northeast Atlantic if you were sailing from ports in England, Scotland, Denmark, or from the German Bight or the Netherlands. So that's really all background that's necessary to understand. If you are thinking about the development of these boats, they started going to Iceland early in the 1890s, and then in the 1892, 93, first commercial journeys there off Iceland. And for example, the total catch, just to give you an idea of the importance of the Icelandic region for the fisheries, total German catch near Iceland in the year 1905 was 13,200 tons, and the total German catch, everything that was caught by German trawlers in that year, was 41,870 tons. That means basically, simplified, one third of the result of the complete German fisheries was coming from the waters of Iceland. If you are doing it for the UK, situation is a little different, but at least 20% of the catch that's landed in British ports is also coming from Iceland. So there's a substantial operation of foreign trawlers off Iceland. And what's going on in Iceland at the same time? If you are thinking about Iceland around, let's say, the 1910s, 1920s, what is it we are seeing? We are seeing a country that is still in a certain colonial dependency from Denmark. And okay, it was no longer a colony, it was a crown union, but they were completely depending on Denmark. And the Danish parliament, Danish crown, was making the decisions on Iceland. And what happened on Iceland itself, basically, who cared about it? They were living on that island in the center of the Atlantic, and nobody cared about them. And at the same time, the local fishing industry was still using open sailboats and open rowboats. They were not industrialized at all. And if you are thinking about the North Atlantic, if you are thinking about climate conditions, if you are thinking about sea conditions in the North Atlantic, that means if you are using open sailboats, if you are using open rowing boats in particular, you are limited to the immediate area of the coast. There's no chance to operate really on the ocean. And so therefore, there was kind of coexistence between these international fishing fleets, the British fishing fleet, the German fishing fleet, and the Icelandic domestic fleet. And in addition, the Icelandic fisheries themselves focused mainly on the western part of Iceland, in particular the area north of the Reykjanes Peninsula and south of Snæfellsnes, and that means so-called Faxaflói, far to the west of Iceland. While the European trawlers were mainly operating in the southeast of Iceland. So there was also at that time, there was a distribution between those two, you might say, competing fishing fleets. And then, even more important, in particular, the German, to a lesser degree, the British trawling fleet, realized that there is another species besides cod, and that means besides Gadus mahua, that there's redfish. Redfish, that means sebastes, and this redfish, nobody on Iceland considered redfish as a fish for human consumption. Redfish was something that could be used as animal food, that could be used as fertilizer, but not for human consumption. Okay, for whatever reason, somebody in Germany realized it is a tasty fish and decided to bring it to the German market. The German market accepted the species. There are certain issues with going for redfish. That means it's kind of semi-poisonous if you're handling it, not the flesh of the fish, but some spikes or thorns. You need to be really careful. But it became really big success in Germany. Still the situation, there was no major conflict between Iceland and international fisheries at that time. And if you're looking there, what is it you are seeing? You are seeing a steam trawler with the crew working on the open deck, and they were not sheltered, and in the middle of the North Atlantic. And what does it mean if you are using a trawler that's not a stern ram trawler, but that is hauling the gear over the side, therefore has a very low freeboard, and therefore basically it means as soon as weather conditions are turning bad, these ships need to stop fishing. So they were at the same time kind of limited in the operational capability. Not as much as the rowing boats, sailboats, but they were limited. More important, when they sailed out to the fishing ground, they needed to return from the fishing ground after 10 days because of the limitation of preserving the fish on ice. So therefore, if there was bad weather and catch was bad, doesn't matter, they needed to return because otherwise the catch wouldn't go to the market in acceptable quality. And so therefore, even at that time, it continued without major problems, this coexistence, you might say. If we are looking at the catch numbers for this time, and in the interval period, Iceland is catching between 150,000 metric tons and 300,000 metric tons per year. The UK is beginning with 75,000 and reaching, let's say, 120. Germany is beginning in 1919 for obvious reasons with zero, and then is reaching a number pretty close to the British. So we are seeing a total of, let's say, 400,000 to 500,000 tons of fish taken from the waters of Iceland at that time. If we are thinking about the ecosystem around Iceland, that is kind of what can be harvested in a responsible way without causing too much damage to that ecosystem. But what else is happening then if we are going into World War II? As all of you know, Iceland during World War II became a relevant stepping stone for basically the European theater, and in particular the air base in Keflavik, and became already established at that time, or beginning in Reykjavik and everything else, but Iceland became really an important stepping stone. And in addition, what happened and what not many people realized, Iceland used the opportunity, put it this way, Denmark was occupied by Nazi forces, and Iceland took the opportunity to declare sovereignty, to cut loose, finally to end the relation with Denmark. That's really an important step in this context, because now there was Iceland had become an independent sovereign nation. In a certain understanding, you might argue that the step of declaring sovereignty, and the Danish exiled government, of course, tried to prohibit this step and tried to postpone it at least after the war. But Icelandic parliament simply decided, no, we are doing it now. And in a certain sense, there was backing by the US for this step, because Iceland, the US, of course, were interested in Iceland as a future partner. And nobody really knew at that time what would happen in Denmark and so on. And you can see a comparable pattern on Greenland. But basically, Iceland was an independent sovereign nation when World War II came to an end. In addition, in 1945, President Truman issued a proclamation to, quote, "having concern for the urgency of conserving and prudently utilizing its natural resources, the government of the U.S. regards the natural resources of the subsoil and seabed of the continental shelf beneath the high seas, but contiguous to the coast of the U.S., as appertaining to the U.S., subject to its jurisdiction and control." Here we are having, for the first time, a major player in the international theater claiming control over the continental shelf without mentioning any mileage. There is not a 3 nautical mile zone. There is no 12 nautical miles mentioned in here. But the wording is the natural resources of the subsoil and seabed of the continental shelf beneath the high seas, blah, 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 blah. So that is the wording. Okay. Talking about subsoil and seabed doesn't apply to fisheries. And as you might know, the background of the Truman Proclamation was basically the question if the states or the federal government would control the offshore oil industry. But there is a wording that complete continental shelf can be controlled by the federal government. That is really the critical point in here. And everybody, in particular in the UK, considered this proclamation as of having absolutely no importance, because it was understood as something between the states and the federal government here in this country. So why should we bother about an internal discussion going on in the US? There's much more we need to think about on our side of the Atlantic. But it became really important quickly after. Okay, if we are now thinking about the Atlantic, the North Atlantic, in the time after World War II, during the Cold War, Iceland is, of course, not only still in the center, but is now of major strategic importance to the conflict. Why? On the one hand, still because of the air base, and you might say this island that was at the same time an aircraft carrier, how it's often described as the aircraft carrier built out of rock. And then in addition, if you're thinking about the shallow areas of the Atlantic, where there might have been a chance to get an idea if a Soviet submarine was basically leaving port and going into the open waters of the Atlantic. And between Greenland, Iceland, and the UK, there's these famous gaps on both sides, the shallow passages, and the boat needs to go on either one side or the other side of Iceland. So if you wanted to control Soviet submarines leaving their home bases in the Russian Arctic area, Iceland was a main place to go for basically figuring out and where these boats were heading. And so therefore, the US had a vital interest in Iceland at that time for geostrategic reasons. At the same time, what happened in British and German fisheries at that time. And the traditional trawler, the traditional sight-set trawler catching fresh fish, that means fish preserved on ice, was replaced by the first stern ramp trawlers. And that means the gear was no longer hauled over the side, but the gear was hauled via a stern ram technology and taken over from the whaling industry. If you are thinking about it, there was simply a ramp at the stern of the ship where the complete gear was hauled onto the deck, and so much more mechanized and could operate under more severe sea conditions, and more important, the ships also started using deep freezing technology, and therefore it was no longer fresh fish, but the fish was frozen on the trawler. And if you're combining all these technologies, all limitations that have been in place due to the old technology were basically no longer existing. A fish that is not preserving its catch on ice, but is basically putting the catch already on board of the ship into the freezer, can stay on sea forever because there's no problem with the preservation of the fish any longer. So if they are encountering bad weather, they were simply just waiting, continuing fishing after it. And so therefore, this new fishing technology now became really a different thing from the Icelandic perspective. These boats could wait for weather, could continue fishing. At the same time, Iceland, with the help of the US to a certain degree, also started motorized fishing. Icelandic fishing fleet was no longer open rowing boat, but it were mainly motorized fishing boats and mid-distance boats, and now they were competing on the same fishing grounds. And now there was a conflict. And what happened? If you're looking at the numbers, and numbers for Icelandic fisheries are increasing moderately but steadily, but the numbers for the British and the German catch, annual catch, are increasing rapidly because of this new technology. And what happened then on the Icelandic side? 1948, Icelandic Parliament is basically deciding and issuing the law on the control over utilization of the fish stocks on the whole shelf. A law on the control over utilization of the fish stocks on the whole shelf. Whole shelf again. That's the same wording as Truman has used, and without anything in particular. Icelandic Parliament is issuing this law, but not enacting any kind of enforcement of it. So it's just a theoretical claim, you might say. And more important, as the US had issued with the Truman Proclamation a very similar claim, Iceland started it, let's see if we can get away with it. And they were able to get away with it. There was no international protest against. Why? If you are thinking about 48, this Icelandic law, in a philosophical understanding, being backed by the US by basically using the precise same wording, if you are thinking about the UK and in particular Germany in 48, no, there was no reason to protest anything on the international level. And so therefore, it simply got not really recognized. And in particular, as there was nothing when it comes to enforcement or an actual extension of the Icelandic fishing limit. 4 years later, that means after Iceland introduced the claim for the whole shelf, but nobody really considered this as being a relevant law, 4 years later, 1952, Iceland extended its fishing limits from 3 nautical miles to 4 nautical miles. 1 mile. You might say 1 mile is more or less nothing, but the problem is this 1 mile included that certain bays were now becoming Icelandic territory from the Icelandic perspective and were no longer accessible to international fisheries, and in particular Faxaflói on the western side of Iceland. But still, it wasn't really big thing going on. 1958, first United Nations Conference on the Law of the Sea. It might be argued that the first United Nations Conference on the Law of the Sea was completely without result, and that's not too bad as an argument, but it could be seen already that there would be a certain sympathy for coastal nations extending their territorial waters. It could be already seen that this old system of everything beyond 3 nautical miles is simply high seas and open to everybody, that this was no longer fully accepted. But again, 58, the first conference remained without major decisions for the fisheries. And after there were no major decisions, Iceland, with the next unilateral decision, extended its fishing limit to 12 nautical miles. As a consequence, now it was no longer acceptable for the British and for the West German fishing fleets that Iceland could get away with something like this. And what happened? As already mentioned earlier, Iceland was extending its waters to 12 nautical miles. The British trawlers in particular continued fishing, and Iceland sent out the Coast Guard vessels to prohibit them from fishing, and the UK considered sending over the Fishery Protection Squadron, but in the first conflict, basically, the first conflict ended after a very short period of time because of there could be negotiations, there was a treaty, and so therefore nothing really happened. Iceland managed to get control over the area, and at the same time, British got a fishing quota in that area. So it could be negotiated at that time. And West Germany at the same time didn't consider itself really in the position for a claim against Iceland at that time. And after there was the British-Icelandic treaty, Germany could negotiate a treaty under very similar conditions. But at the beginning of the conflict, there had been kind of some small clashes, nothing really serious. But more important, on both sides, it became a highly loaded topic for domestic policy and for domestic discussion. This, for example, and I really would have liked to shown you these cartoons from the Icelandic newspaper from that time, but there's one I really like, and I think that's easy enough to visualize. And think about an Icelander sitting in its bathtub and simply taking a bath. And then stereotypical John Bull comes along with his toy boats. And the Icelander didn't understand why John Bull wants to play with his toy boats in his bathtub. And I think that's really important that for the Icelandic, from the Icelandic perspective, the concept of ownership, from the Icelandic perspective, Icelandic economy at that time was depending to more than 90%, 90, on fisheries. So for them, it was theirs. It was simply the same as the farmland on which they were breeding sheep. The fishing grounds offshore were as critical or even more critical for their economy than anything else, and therefore their mindset was, these fishing grounds off our coast are ours. And of course they knew the concept of the freedom of the seas, but considered it as a kind of not really applicable to the areas immediately off their coast. And so there was this conflict going on that could be settled by a treaty. And but more important, already during that conflict, a new weapon was introduced. It is a simple, it is a wire cutter. It's basically a wire cutter, and it's kind of a dragon that's towed behind a Coast Guard vessel and is able to cut the trawl wires of a fishing trawler. Think about minesweeping gear in a certain sense. And minesweeping gear where you are cutting a mine and that it comes up, they modified it to a very simple tool that could be utilized to cut the fishing gear of a trawler while this trawler was fishing. And if you are thinking about something like this, it is a weapon in a certain understanding. But what is it causing? It's causing substantial economic damage. Why substantial economic damage? Because normally, distant water trawler might have a spare gear. Normally not. And so normally if you are cutting the gear, that means you are losing the journey, you need to return home. In addition, in financial terms, in today's market, if I'm using a modern gear, you are talking about, let's say, 2 million or something like this for a fishing gear of one of these boats. And it was basically the same dimension at that time. So it's a highly efficient, very primitive weapon that could be utilized to stop the trawlers trawling. And why was it that the Icelandic Coast Guard was really happy about it? Because using something like this kept the conflict, of course, at a very low scale of intensity. And when I was doing research on this one, I was able to sit together with the, at that time, second in command of the Icelandic Coast Guard, and we were able to compare the number of live rounds shot in the whole conflict on, according to Icelandic archives, according to German and British archives. And we had a slight discrepancy. We couldn't agree if it was 12 or 15 individual rounds that were shot. And so therefore, you are getting an idea what this conflict was about. But the problem was, and that was what he told me, that was his greatest fear, that his young captains would go crazy and would sink a fishing trawler, regardless if British or German, because then the conflict would have become much more intense. And on the other hand, if you are thinking about the larger political surrounding international scenery, think about an Icelandic Coast Guard cutter, boat of, let's say, 200 foot, and with a single cannon on board, nothing spectacular, and that's it. And maybe a 3-inch or something like this. And on the other side, you are having the big frigates of the home fleet, because the frigates of the home fleet were the frigates that were used for the Fishery Protection Service. Now think about how is this recognized between NATO members. Who is the bully? Who is the one who is playing overly aggressive? And that's for the British-Icelandic conflict. And if I'm now moving forward towards the other element of it, that means the German-Icelandic conflict, what was it that Germany was doing? Germany was doing in this conflict in 1972, about now 50-mile discussion, Germany was doing precisely the same as the UK was doing. Germany was sending over their fishery protection boats and fishery protection service boats. German fishery protection service, after World War II, as mentioned in the beginning, was not rebuilt as part of the German Navy, because the protection service started immediately in 45, while the Navy, as you know, became later on. And therefore, fishery protection service was built under, as being a part of the Ministry of Agriculture. And these ships, officially, according to international treaties, are hospital ships. Now, think about the same situation of Iceland. What is it? There's an Icelandic Coast Guard cutter going against a British fishery protection vessel. Means small Coast Guard cutter going against a frigate of the home fleet. On the other hand, Icelandic Coast Guard cutter against a German fishery protection vessel. Armed Coast Guard cutter against a civilian hospital ship. Think about it. And so that is, and there was no intent in it. It simply happened. And then there was the volcanic eruption on Jaime, and that's one of the most interesting points in this whole history. Once there was the volcanic eruption on Jaime, and these hospital ships and the British frigate immediately stopped operations and offered to help Icelandic people to evacuate the island. And so it was named by an Icelandic historian as the art to carry out war between friends. And that's one of the descriptions. And that was, yeah, really going on at that time. One of the few casualties, for example, it was a crew member of a British trawler, if I'm correct. And he got struck by one of the trawl wires and got really badly injured. The same Icelandic Coast Guard cutter that cut the trawl wire and caused the situation took over that Icelandic fisherman, brought him to port, and saved his life. So that's kind of this very strange conflict going on at that time. And what happened during this conflict at the same time? This is what's going on at the sea. And as you know, if you have such international low-scale conflict, then there are also attempts to solve these these issues at the International Court of Justice, the OECD, the GATT, and means that all these international mechanisms, all of them failed. Why did they fail? Because either Iceland or the UK and Germany declined competency of these institutions. So there was simply both sides agreed, no, we can't do it. And both sides were kind of okay with continuing this conflict, you might say. And then in the mid-70s, we are now to 75, the UK and Iceland had signed a treaty again. Germany, because of not using the Navy, did not sign a treaty and continued the conflict low scale. And so basically between 72 and 75, there was an ongoing conflict in the Icelandic area. What was really going on? Iceland was cutting fishing gears. And on the other hand, British and German fisheries tried to continue fisheries as good as they could. And in the negotiations at that time, I think I can clearly state from reading the minutes from these negotiations, while Iceland was really looking for a solution to the conflict, neither the UK nor Germany were really interested in a solution to the conflict. Why not? As long as they could convince Iceland and other nations that they were honest in attempting to finding a solution, they could continue fishing. And they knew at that time how a potential treaty would have looked. And so losing 10 or even 20 fishing gears per year was expensive, but there was still more fish that was landed that easily financed these fishing gears. And so therefore, so you might wonder, why is this conflict not going on forever? And if you're reading basically whatever has been published about it, the end is kind of vague. And then at a certain moment, the international negotiations on the law of the sea are making really big steps forward. We are seeing the negotiations for the third United Nations Conference of the Law of the Sea, and we are seeing the idea of an exclusive economic zone becoming more broader accepted. And Iceland is realizing that they could utilize this movement, also supported by the Soviet Union to a certain degree. And more important, Iceland is making the active threat to leave NATO and to go into whatever kind of economic cooperation with the Soviet Union. Iceland at these years has sometimes left-leaning governments, and they are making this active threat to leave NATO. And if you're thinking about this one, that would have been a substantial blow to all kind of efforts going on in the Cold War if Iceland would have left NATO. And that is their main argument. From the British perspective, this argument isn't really that relevant. And from the German perspective, same situation. From the American perspective, it is a critical argument and a point that needs to be avoided at all costs, you might say, Iceland leaving NATO. But if you are thinking about it, the US isn't party to that conflict. And so there we are. Then in 76, the UK is realizing that the use of the frigates of the Home Fleet isn't really efficient. And now they are coming up with different approach. And that means the British government is chartering two salvage tug boats from private companies and putting them under the flag of the Fishery Protection Service. And what is it these boats are doing? These boats are simply trying to ram and the Icelandic Coast Guard cutters. And now it's really becoming serious for the Icelanders, because it was kind of obvious that a frigate would never sink basically an Icelandic Coast Guard cutter. But now with the salvage tugs being used in a way that put the Icelandic Coast Guard cutter at risk of sinking or even a direct ramming, now it became really ugly out on the water. And in addition, and that is a point where we have, I think, enough evidence to state that this was the end, there was a NATO summit. And during that NATO summit, there was negotiations at the side on the conflict. And at a certain moment, we can, without seeing the minutes of the particular negotiations, they are still not open to historical research, but we need to assume that the US simply told Britain and Germany to give in. And I think that's the best assumption we have, and I have read some material in Icelandic archive that is clearly suggesting this, because what is actually happening? On the ocean, on the fishing grounds, the conflict is going on. The negotiations and the bilateral or trilateral negotiations are going on. There's a NATO summit. And 5 days after the NATO summit, and there's a treaty. It's simply after the NATO summit, there's an immediate treaty. And so we clearly need to assume that somebody explained to the UK and Germany that fish might be important, that there might be an economic value in fish, but that you should not really compare this economic value of fish to the strategic value of Keflavik Air Base, and so therefore, or Naval Air Station, and that fish versus Naval Air Station, that the decision needs to go for the Naval Air Station at that time in the Cold War. We are still in the Cold War at that time, of course, or we are in the heydays of the Cold War. So that is how this conflict came to an end, that you might say at a certain moment all three nations involved, Iceland, UK, and West Germany to a certain degree, realized that a conflict among NATO members, we are talking about a naval conflict among NATO members, all three nations, and wasn't something that should be continued in the mid-1970s, in particular as the conflict now was at the brink of leaving this kind of toying around with some fishing gears, and now it became really a conflict where loss of life was a foreseeable situation, and then we are seeing it. What happened after it? And after it, Iceland, 1976, the last foreign trawlers are leaving fishing grounds of Iceland. It's not really true. Very small number of Belgium trawlers continued for, I think, another 10 years to work off Iceland, because Belgium very early had signed a treaty with Iceland, and that provided them fishing rights into the 1980s. So these were the only European trawlers that could continue, but two or three boats, and so nothing to mention in numbers. But more important, going back to Grotius and the Mare Liberum, the free seas, no, the waters of Iceland were no longer free seas. They became Mare Clausum, the closed seas, the nationalized seas, and in terms of use of the fish stocks in these grounds. And for Iceland, it was, of course, a big victory. And when it comes to thinking about reshaping the landscape of the Atlantic, you might say, and I used it in one of my publications, Iceland gained complete sovereignty only in 1976, because in 1944, Iceland had gained political sovereignty. But what is political sovereignty without sovereignty over your one and only economic resource? It's basically incomplete. Or you might say decolonization came to an end only in 76. That might be another way to look on it. Why? How? Because of mainly the US in 45 stating and initiating a process that the whole continental shelf can be used by a coastal nation, can be owned, operated, and controlled by a coastal nation. I'm not embarking in this discussion, but if you are thinking about this, and the Truman Proclamation helped to develop the concept of the 200-mile exclusive economic zone and extended control rights over huge ocean territories off the coast. And on the other hand, the US also still operating freedom of navigation operations. It's an interesting situation, and just to think about. But if we are thinking about the Icelandic perspective, it was really the breakthrough for the nation, and when it comes to identity of the nation, when it comes to what makes modern Iceland, and one big element in this one is, you might say, we were able to defeat the Royal Navy, a navy that hasn't been defeated before in the last 200 years or something like this, Now they are putting it into this perspective that they were able to defeat it. And you might say it's true. On the other hand, it's definitely not true. They haven't defeated the Royal Navy, and they wouldn't ever been able. But I think what they have defeated successfully is the notion that the North Atlantic is owned by European nations. And they have defeated it in a way, and then, of course, Newfoundland, Canada, and all the other nations, Greenland to a certain degree, following with extending exclusive economic zones, national fishing limits, and therefore this big step forward of the resources should be utilized by the coastal nations that belong to the North Coastal Nation. When it comes to recent developments on Iceland, I think there are two points I would like to use here to illustrate how important it is what's going on Iceland, or how important this historic development is for Icelandic history and identity. Young historian, historian of my generation, he wrote a well-known book about the conflict, Thorsker Strillen, and his name is Gudni Johannesson, and a couple of years ago when I was flying to a conference somewhere on the globe, I woke up to the news that a guy named with this name has been elected Icelandic president, and so therefore Icelandic president today is a fisheries historian by training, and whenever you are talking with him, he is always telling his audience that he is only taking a leave of absence from his university positions because he considers himself still as a historian working in this field. And so I think if a nation is electing a fisheries historian who was not really active in politics before as a president for that nation and is re-electing this person, and so tells you something about the importance of that thinking, that way of thinking for the identity of the country. In addition, a couple of years ago, I think it was 2005, now I need to take you to the Icelandic south coast and to a small place named Vík í Mýrdal and go with you on a dark volcanic beach. And think about this beach, and in the background there are the mountains, and to the east is the Sandur, that means you might say a coastal desert, one of the most hostile environments you can find on Iceland. If you are going to that place today, you will find a small monument at the shore, and it is Icelandic basalt, and 12 stones of Icelandic basalt, and in the middle is a granite, a very large granite, 5 tons weight or something like this. Problem is, on Iceland there's no granite, and so it's a project we did in the early 2000s. It is a monument for the German fishermen and British fishermen that lost their life at that coast, and at the same time with the Icelandic stones for the Icelanders who helped them to survive. And this monument was established on the German and Icelandic side by people that were actively involved in these conflicts. And for them, today, or now 15 years ago, it was more important to think about how they were cooperating, you might say, they and their predecessors, in case of when survival was at question, then thinking about the conflict. And I think that's really important, that these nations, it was kind of substantial conflict. It was really serious. It was not that they considered the conflict as a sport or something like this, but they were able to come to a solution that is acceptable for both sides.